I will thank you for your nice presentation and lecture. Can you throw some light on medicines which you use in daily practice? And secondly, is there any research, or can you also again throw some light on research on single herbs or say rasa ushadhi?
Well, again, the medicine, I assume you're talking about Ayurvedic medicine, I hope so. Is that right? So the herbs and herbal formation, they are also time sensitive, is that right? So the virya in the herb is also depending upon the time. Whether you talk about Shita virya or Ushna virya, they are all sensitive to time. They are all sensitive to the elements of the nature and the soil and the sunlight and where it is grown and how it is collected and how it is prepared and what is the shelf life. So those are all effectiveness. So the whole science of Ayurvedic pharmacology and even Bhaishajya Kala, that the administration of the medicine is totally based upon the concept of time. What is the right thing to do at right time? The administration of the medicine, the selection, the collection, the preparation, all of that is totally time-based itself.
Sir, I wish to know which medicines you use there, say single herbs, names, or say preparations.
Yeah, we use single herbs, we use herbal combinations. There are lots of good quality natural Ayurvedic organic herbs that are available in the United States. So we use single herbs, we use some combination in some cases. I personally believe in heavy changes in diet and lifestyle and very little with herbs and herbal formulations. Herb and herbal formulations, I use them more like crutches, something to keep them amused. Most of the work is done by the diet and lifestyle changes. Very little is done with the herbs. And I think it's always safe to do that, because the moment you take it away and you keep them following those things, it works perfectly. In some cases, you have to combine the herbs. We don't have the luxury to have the rasa ushadhi in United States because of various reasons. I believe in it if it is prepared properly. There's no shortcut that should be used, because then it remains into its unhealthy forms, which can be toxic and dangerous for the body. We always use metals and use those various juices for swaras and bhavana and churning them and cultivating them. So we change their biological form to create more of a nanoparticle size, which is totally herbalized and totally bioavailable. So if it is done properly in a short amount of time, it's very effective. I believe in that. I don't get to use that as often. But again, my request to all of you is to use as little herbs and herbal formulation as possible and really create this template of dietary lifestyle do's and don'ts and emotional healing, psycho-emotional healing, lifestyle changes, and some personalized recommendation to make those changes in diet and lifestyle itself. Even the spices are so powerful. Even simple use of spices can be as effective as any herbs and formulations together. And as I said, that I actually practice much better Ayurveda in that country than what I used to practice here, because of the limitations. That creates more creativity, and that makes you more connected with what is right to be done at that time.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So, myself, Dr. Sujata Pawar, I'm from Pune. I have two questions. Firstly, I want to know about the global opportunities for VBMS doctors. Do we need to take additional degrees or something like that? And how do we approach for the opportunities and all? And secondly, I also wanted to, just a curiosity sake, that you're the chairman of an Ayurvedic college over there. So what's the curriculum? Is it the same like we follow here in India, like the Charak and Sushruta, all these granthas? Or is it different over there? Like, how is it followed? Thank you.
Okay, so number one, the Ayurvedic education in the United States is way different than what you guys study, okay? They don't have access to real classical literature. They don't know enough about Sanskrit to refer those, even though they are available in English as such. So we do use a lot of things from classical literature, but we simplify them for our educational purposes. They do study the basics of Ayurveda and Swastavritta and all the sciences. They are divided. It's a three-year course. The first year training, which is somewhere close to 1,000 hours, is called as Ayurvedic Health Counselor. The second year training, which is about 1,500 hours, is called as Ayurvedic Health Practitioner. And the third category, which is the Masters of Ayurveda, that category, which is somewhere close to 3,000 hours of training. Not all the schools are able to have three-year curriculum, but that's the standard template. We have a national organization in the United States called as National Ayurvedic Medical Association, or NAMA, as we call it. And we have a database of somewhere close to 2,000 Ayurvedic practitioners who are practicing in the United States. Currently, there is no licensure for you to practice Ayurveda, but there are certain states in the country. There are about 14 states. California is one of them. New Mexico is one of them. Arizona is one of them. Washington State is one of them, where they have passed an act called as Health Freedom Act, where you disclose your educational training. Say if you are moving to California, then you will say, I'm Dr. Pawar and I went to the school in India. I'm a classically trained Ayurvedic physician. This is my degree. This is my certificate, but I don't have a license to practice in this country. I'm not trying to diagnose, treat, or cure, or prescribe any medication to you. What we are going to talk about is an individualized wellness session. We will use maybe herbs, spices, herbal formulation that we'll recommend. We'll make some diet and lifestyle changes. They understand it, you understand it, they sign it, you sign it. It's a consent. It's an informed consent, and then you are legally safe to practice Ayurveda. So there's a great opportunity for Ayurvedic doctors, if you are good, to go out and really educate. It starts with education, so you need to find some Ayurvedic schools or motivate some people to teach some short courses and classes, and slowly start seeing maybe some clinical interactions. We have quite a few people who visit overseas regularly. And so in the United States, every state legislation is different, so you just have to be cautious a little bit, but it's all doable. There are so many BMS doctors. There's another organization just for BMS doctors called APNA, and we have about 200-300 BMS doctors in United States who are practicing. Not all of them are practicing everything. There are some do's and don'ts for legalities for Panchakarma and things like that, which are county-based and legal structure-based and licensed massage therapist and things. But as of now, there's no licensure. Very soon, it will have licensure in certain states. And once we have that, it'll open the floodgates. You can become a member of NAMA even if you are living in this country. You can become a member of National Ayurvedic Medical Association. They will enter you in the database. If you ever come and visit US, you can come and attend a conference. You can give some talks. There's a lot of opportunities in counseling work, in Panchakarma, in lifestyle medicine, in hospital-based care and maintenance itself. Lots of opportunities for herbal products and companies. Every day we have lots of new companies that are coming up. There are mainstream medical schools like Duke Medical School, Harvard Medical School, UC Davis Medical School. There are lots of Ayurvedic doctors and practitioners who are trained in both. So it's a great environment right now, very, very conducive. The more our students know about it, the more easier it's going to get. You need to read some books, be available for constant learning and upgrading and updating your information so that it's not the ancient, outdated Ayurveda that you talk about, but something in the light, which is crisp, which is clear, which is commonsensical and very practical. Yes, sir. Are we done?
Yeah. Thank you. Actually, the interaction will continue informally. Yeah, please. Yeah.
So after getting graduated here, is it necessary that we go there and do some course to practice?
There's no need. There's no need to do any course to practice as such. If you want to learn and probably get a specific licensure to do something, you can always do some additional training. Means if you want to become a massage therapist to actually show, demonstrate certain things, it's somewhere close to 500 hours of training, which you can do it in a few months. You can go and do an MPH-like training, which is Master's in Public Health, in order for you to work in a hospital setting or something. You can look for some additional trainings if you look for. There are some Ayurvedic doctors who have gone and become physical therapists, who is a licensed profession. But if you are a good Ayurvedic doctor and you become a certified yoga instructor, I think you can do a wonderful practice.
In the same line, I would like to ask, California is the most progressive state, what people say. And will California follow Switzerland and Russia in regulating Ayurveda or accepting Ayurveda as formal system? What is the future? What is the status and future?
Switzerland is a very tiny little country, and the legislation and regulations are different, even though we hear a lot about Sama and what they're doing. It's still not fully recognized yet in Switzerland also. It is an illusion that is fully recognized. I think currently with the given situation, I don't see any other country more easily as United States to practice freely Ayurveda in certain states. Portugal is a good model. Argentina is developing a template that would happen through their own educational system and things like that. Russia is putting legislation. At the end of the day, it boils down to money. We always say it's nothing to do with money, but it all boils down to money. So even the state government will have to find out where the money is going to come from. Why these doctors who are going to practice, that we need to issue a license for them, how they're going to earn a living, how they're going to pay us back for the licensure fee and everything, for controlling and regulating things. So it is boiling down to those things. Currently, the economy in the United States, how many people go to not primary care physicians, but someone who is unlicensed profession, it's a staggering statistics. The most developed, most literate country in the world, 3/4 of the healthcare is maintained by non-licensed practitioners. $800 billion are spent on herbs and herbal formulations every year that people buy out of pocket. They just spend this money on their own. America is a totally consumer-based country. They like products, they like Ayurvedic product, they like to see the products and the benefits of that. FDA is heavily regulating the claims of it. You cannot claim that this is curing your liver cirrhosis, you cannot claim that this is fixing this disease, but some associated claims and some glorified claims, people are willing to buy those things, they're going to see the benefits of this, and there are hundreds and hundreds of Ayurvedic companies which are doing thriving business. So it's a great opportunity. It's a big country, it's a lot of growth, lot of money, and lot of openness and willingness. Because everything is coming out in English, and there's lots of Ayurvedic books that are available in good English that people can read and listen and understand. So I welcome all of you to come and count me in. Any help or support you need, you can find about me from my website, ayurvedichealing.net. And that's my phone number in the United States. So feel free to contact me, anything that you need from my side, okay?
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for your time and very elaborate interaction and sharing experiences. It's time for conclusion. Many people, they actually helped us arranging this program. Dr. Suhas Kshirsagar himself, his family, our Savitribai Phule University State Department, all Ayurveda colleges, principals of Ayurveda colleges, International Academy of Ayurveda, National Institute of Nutrition, Preeti Abhyankar, and my friend Shri Shraut. Before we conclude, there are a few announcements. The center has received a grant from Department of Health Research, Government of India, and we are soon announcing a winter school for 1 month where we will get opportunity to interact with many experts and learn many new things. That announcement will be shared through emails, the details. We have arranged a tea and a group photo. We will have group photo first and then we will have tea. Thank you all for your time and making this masterclass a very good evening, a very good interaction. I will conclude with this Shanti Mantra. Sarve pi sukhinas santu, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pashantu, ma kashchit dukkha bhag bhavet. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Thank you.